keine Zeit zu kuscheln.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with the loser bracket semi-final. The first player will drop out of this qualifier for 2 slots and $15,000. Here at WCA European Qualifier 2016, it's either going to be Shaddai or Thomas G.
Hey, we haven't even mentioned that yet. There's so much money this year for the qualifier. Last year, there was an offline qualifier at Gamescom, which was a lot of fun, by the way, where we saw some of you guys, and that was really cool. This time, it's all online, but as you said, 15,000, man, that's a hell of a lot of cash. Neil, what's the distribution like exactly?
The winner will take home $7,600 and, of course, a slot to China. The runner-up will earn himself $4,500 and a slot to China. The third place will, of course, be super unhappy to not qualify for WCA, but he still gets rewarded with $3,000 here.
But fourth place gets nothing.
Nothing.
Just like last year, we remember poor Rudan, man. He had to cut his vacation short. He came via the last plane to Germany, and he had only his shorts with him and t-shirts, just as, you know, bathing stuff and flip-flops.
Yeah, just imagine the weather then being right now in Hamburg. It's just raining all day, yeah. And then a Rudan.
Freaking Hamburg, man. It's like, I was telling you, what? I don't want to bring a suit. It's going to be so warm. It's summer. And he's like, dude, it's Hamburg. There's no summer here.
No summer.
There's seriously no summer here. It's terrible.
We celebrate summer with not wearing rain jackets.
It's depressing, man. It's depressing. It's a really cool city, though, but the weather sucks.
That's why I'm such an emo and listen to Slipknot and stuff.
You still do, huh?
No, I never did, but the guy on Reddit said so.
I mean, Slipknot isn't emo music, right?
No.
Slipknot is like...
But you haven't read...
I'm angry music.
But you haven't read the Reddit thread about all the personalities in Warcraft? It was quite funny.
When did that come up?
A couple of days ago. That's because you don't hang out at Twitter, man. It would all...
I hang out on Reddit usually, though. I don't know, must have been busy.
They described you as also an emo who listens to a lot of rock music. So that's how accurate the descriptions were. Well, it was quite funny, so...
Okay, Reddit, I have to read up on that, though.
It's reddit.com/r/WC3. If you want to stay in touch with the Warcraft community here, that is definitely the place to go, as well as tft.w3arena.net. And if you want to keep yourself up to date with tournaments, with schedules and everything, we have, of course, wiki.backtowarcraft.com and calendar.backtowarcraft.com. Two nice little sources for information about Warcraft 3.
Wiki.backtowarcraft.com?
Yeah, it's the link to Liquipedia.
Oh, okay.
I thought it's easier than wiki.teamliquid.net/Warcraft.
Wouldn't it be easier, wiki.warcraft.com?
So
you want to get some commercials in there, right?
You think we own the domain warcraft.com?
Well,
you really think Blizzard didn't take care of that?
Yeah, all right. All right, screw
you. Oh, Remo. So cute.
Warcraft3.com. There's no domain owned there.
I think it will. So, we go into the first game here of Thomas G versus Shaddai. Russia versus Denmark, the two losers of the winner bracket semifinals. Gonna show you the grid once more. This is what happened so far. Hawk beat Shaddai 2-1. Warchief killed Thomas G with a 2-0. And the winner of this best of three will face Hawk for the final slot to the playoffs in Group A. Remo, there's not anything to talk about, so.
So you can move over so I can cuddle with you.
Let's go in game. The first map is Amazonia.
All right, and already we see a bit of deviation against... never mind. We are seeing different matchup, obviously. Gotta get used to it. All right, so these are the two underdogs in the group. The favorites did pull through in the end. It got a little bit hairy for Hawk in his first series against Shaddai, but in the end, he did take it. Now we have Shaddai versus Thomas G. And I was asking, before we went into the break, out of these two underdogs, who do we give the edge here to? Who do we expect to... be, you know, taking this more likely than the other, because we don't really see too much of them. Shaddai is a fairly active ladder player. Thomas G has come back for this WCA qualifier, but we haven't seen too much from him. But the recent results, they speak a definite language, and that is Thomas G has had some great results. He has defeated Cechi, actually, coming here. Getting through the open qualifier, and maybe more notably, Shaddai's record against Night Elf it ain't too pretty.
Absolutely horrible. We read it before we went into the break, but this is really, it didn't catch my eye before when I did these statistics, but 1 to 11 map score versus Hawk. 0 to 6, Hawk is of course human, sorry. 0 to 6 versus Warchief. 0 to 3 versus Rudin. 1 to 10 versus Sonic. Definitely, these guys are a different caliber than Thomas G at the moment, but this shows that this guy must not feel comfortable against Night Elf.
Yeah, if you put them together there against the top Night Elves, it is 20 map losses, 1 map win.
Disaster!
That is absolutely horrible. That might be the worst matchup for any given player in any given matchup that we have. So, probably not going to be feeling comfortable here getting into this.
On the other side, we have Thomas G. Is he familiar with the current state of Undead versus Night Elf? I think he is. He beat Chechy, as you mentioned. He before beat Sheik, who is also a very good Undead player, who is participating in Group D together with Foggy, Cash, and Yaz in this qualifier. And he beat him. So he knows how to play the Undeads here. He must feel comfortable to a degree. And Thomas G has a big skill base to come from, so he doesn't need to be practicing very, very hard to be on a good level of Warcraft play. So I would actually give him an edge here now. Usually I think that Shaddai is the better player, but, well, right now, but...
Yeah, I think especially I would give the edge here to Thomas G as well, especially seeing how few maps only Shaddai was able to take against the top dogs. Yes, Thomas G might be a tier lower, but still the same matchup, and that oftentimes is a big deal for players what matchup they're playing. Alright, now though, we're gonna stick to the game and not make too many predictions of who's ahead or who has the edge or who doesn't. Tier 2 has been started by both quite a bit earlier for Undead, that's kind of what we're expecting. Thomas G maybe delaying his attack a little bit more than is the standard. Now, Gruul's being used to creep up simultaneously, this might open up some space here for the Demon Hunter, because getting level 3 early with the Boots of Speed, that gives the Night Elf so much space going into the mid game, because the Demon Hunter will be king on the playground.
That is absolutely correct, and against ghouls you only need a few strives from his Warglades to kill off the ghouls. He's a little too late to kill the graveyard, and I think the firepower is not high enough in general, but he's causing some troubles here, and he's disturbing the creep, which is always nice. The Death Knight still level 1, quite far away. And yeah, no coil. But Night Elf against the Demon Hunter, you always go for the aura first. But it's gonna be hard to get experience here.
Thomas G, he has his archers close, but he doesn't quite want to drag him towards his army. Doesn't want to get them surrounded. Would love to steal this one rogue over there, but walking into a surround, definitely a possibility. Here come the archers finally, with a perfect timing basically. He's gonna get a ghoul here most likely, actually just barely escapes into the safety of the base. The rogue goes towards the DK, almost level 2 now. The burns are starting to come out, the skeletons being nicely microed back, a little early maybe. But the archers, they're not in danger, they're not gonna die. DK taking a lot of damage, and especially if Thomas G goes for what for the Naga, this might come into play. Speaking of second heroes, we see the Lich for the other.
Hey, Flying Sheep, welcome to the stream. Yeah, despite all the statistics that we mentioned before, it's the Panda. I think Shaddai versus Hawk has definitely overperformed. So maybe he's in a good shape today, and maybe he can break this trauma that the Night Elves gave him.
Yeah, maybe, but I don't really think that any real signs point towards that direction. Now the natural being creeped by the Night Elf, the DK is coming in for the harass, but he didn't get the Naga. Oh, getting very low. He has a heal potion, however, uses it right now, gets rid of one of the archers, but there's no backup to this. It's only a DK, nothing else.
This is, I don't really know why he's going for that, man, and how his life was just melting away from everything that the Night Elf threw at him. He traded a heal potion for for an archer. This is horrible. And I don't... this is very passive game by Shaddai. Of course, Thomas G forces him into that passive game. But usually, in this very matchup, what's the Lich doing there all alone? We see a group of ghouls, like the cavalry, running across the map, trying to creep Jack the Night Elf, trying to do some harass in the base, trying to get a moonwell or something. Maybe delay the tier 2 buildings. They just want to show presence. And this is completely non-existent in this game.
Yeah, I don't really know what was going on. You could have easily pulled the ghouls. How many ghouls do they have in total? There's 5 right here. And in the main, there's two more. So it's not that many ghouls. He might not even get the frenzy upgrade when he's trying to... But this is weird. When he goes for the Lich, usually you want to go for creeping instead. He could have definitely gone for the Naga and pulled the ghouls earlier. I don't know, this is looking... I guess this is looking like it's not coming perfectly together for Shaddai at all.
And he cancels the harass already, kinda. He has the first Fiend, which is usually a little power spike in the undead play, because you have the Lich, you have a Nova, you have the piercing damage against the Dryads that are coming up. But Thomas G looks very, very confident in this one. The Panda progress is fairly good, level 2.3 already.
He does go for the Frenzy though, by the way. This was a very quick tier 3, and maybe that was the reason why he left the ghouls at home for so long. He wanted to get as much lumber as quickly as possible. Does he have the resources for the Naga? No, he doesn't.
He's supply stuck. Exactly. A little longer. The Ziggurat is quite far away from being finished. When the Volusion is okay, gives you a lot of information if he keeps them. He's going for the orb now, of course. But the Death Knight is missing, and Thomas G, is he able to scout him? No, he's too far away, so Shaddai's movement here is alright. No level 3 Death Knight, and no level 3 Demon Hunter.
Or Nova to greet the army here. The Archer will most certainly be falling, will be denied. The Panda is only level 2. And the Ancient of War actually died to the creeps earlier on, so there's no more easily creepable spots to take until there are Massa Bears, and they're quite a bit away, but so is Destroyer Form Upgrade. So even though he had a lot of ghouls in the main, he doesn't necessarily... He had the lumber, actually, he just forgot about it. Now here we finally see the Naga, and it's usually the timing push, but there's something missing, something very important, and that are the Destroyers.
To that. This is going to take some time. Thomas G on the other side is on tier 3, will start the master training for the bears. Here we go, 30 seconds, and then he has it. So it lines up perfectly with the destroyer upgrade form, I think. But Shaddai is getting a little more presence on the map, so it feels like he feels more comfortable. On the other side, Thomas G getting his mercenary, which is of course always very, very nice. Will be double level 3 for him, and the shop definitely a weaker spot to take, but... Here comes a little go with Frenzy Ghouls, with Triple Hero combo, and with Destroyer form. So this is quite hard.
It's a lot of damage. I think Thomas G has to TP soon. Nice item, Rune Praises, and finding level 3 for the Panda. That was a very important spot to take. He loses the shop, but nothing more. And he has the Staff and the Orb of Venom already. That first Breath of Fire hitting fairly well. One Ghoul to die immediately. Here comes the Destroyer, but this is looking like a fearsome Night Elf army already.
Yeah, and he has only one Fiend. This is definitely not enough. Coil hits them, but he wants to get rid of it as fast as possible. What a Breath of Fire! Being countered by a Heal Scroll immediately. Or was it? I think so. Yeah, he has to Town Portal out. There was no chance. His Ghoul army is kind of completely erased.
Yeah, this strategy is not working perfectly for Shaddai. When you go for this push, you really want to not be facing a level 3 Panda. He tried to go for harassment at the natural creep, didn't really work. He tried to go for some push later on, the destroyers were late, he couldn't keep him from creeping, he went for the merc camp, got a nice item and level 3. I think now we're starting to head into the late game. This is a fantastic position for Thomas G, and he's feeling very confident, creeping his opponent natural. And Shaddai is going for the Frostworm tech, at least he has the sacrificial pit. But
that's gonna take so much time. I don't think he can afford this. And Thomas G, man, the RNGesus is with him here at this on this very map. Rune Bracers and now the big Inwell Potion. This Demon Hunter is safer than Fort Knox.
And now he might be even able to get the other Merc Camp going in. Banner Burn going out again. There is Riju. Can he dispel it? Destroyer can't reach. Arms not long enough. and the DH, of course, the Rune Bracers being so nice in this position. Could try to go in again, maybe a little bit scary. I don't think the Panda has a second staff. No, he doesn't. But two big invults, right?
Yep.
That's, of course, fantastic inventory. Keep your heroes alive and you'll be fine, usually.
Shaddai has no town portal anymore. One invul, one healed scroll. Of course, you need the healed scroll against the area of effect from the Panda. This time he has more fiends. Of course, all the ghouls are gone. But does he really need them? We'll see about that. Coil on the Death Knight. He's focusing him really hard. I don't think that's the big solution here. Breath of Fire is coming in. The Fiends don't really have the time to do the shots on the Dryads here. First one is falling. Nice little micro, but not good enough.
And the heroes are totally out of mana. I guess the Naga has a little bit of mana, but the Lich and the DK totally dry. Now the Demon in trouble. There is no staff, but there is an invul. Uses it right now. Wants to look for some more pickup. Found one Fiend. This Dryad slow will be there, of course, but Dryads are falling as well. But so will this Fiend, and that's, of course, a good trade for the Night Elf. Invul will be running out soon. May have to be careful again. There is no staff, and now the Bear's starting to fall. He's fighting on Blight. Invul is over, but the DK may have to be careful as well. He can't get into the base, the Naga, but the TP out comes. The DK, will he survive? I think so. No Breath of Fire mana. And he does survive.
Hoo-hoo-hoo. Shaddai living on the edge here with the Naga about to fall and the Death Knight super duper close, but he kept the Obsidian Statues on the ground, not overcommitting to destroyers, not going into upkeep, so he can heal up now quite fast. On the other side, we have Moon Juice, we have Rejuvenation. The Night Elves know how to recover from fights like that, and the Invul Potion is off cooldown already. The Panda might be a little exposed, though.
So surprised he's not going for a second staff. It's so strong. If one of your heroes gets low, you use the invul. If he gets focused again, you staff him out. Oh, nice Breath of Fire getting the shade there. Really lucky. And he finds another camp. This could also drop a big item.
The Magi! It's amazing! And Shaddai, he does really not want to engage. He has Death Knight still down. He has a potion and a heal score and an invul, so it's kind of nice. But how long can he sustain in this fight, man? Three bears still up in the air. Only one destroyer. He has no mana, so he's not as powerful. The Lich Invul Potion!
He's not so fast, though. He's not too fast. He's gonna chase him. 7 seconds invul should be running out in 3, 2, 1. Boom. That was a nice countdown. Nice block here coming from the bear, getting rid of one of the statues. Just barely. The Lich, 2 HP. He's not being microed. Oh, the heal scroll just barely saving him. But Thomas G, man, seems like he can do whatever he wants. Yeah. Everything's working.
He's so confident in this. Nice Breath of Fire again. This was the last one, though, but he has more mana burns. He wants to wait, though. It's understandable, but yeah, this row of the Magi is helping, of course. But Shaddai, 47 food, the heroes are getting better and better over time. He still needs the 3-3-3, or the 4-3-3, whatever you want to go for. But he keeps his fiends on the ground. And I feel that this is very important in this matchup, because you really need them against the Dryads. That's the mistake that a lot of European undeads do. Not enough fiends on the ground, so the Dryads stretch to pieces, or your air army at least. Now he's starting to lose some. Demon Hunter too strong for this one. But the first hero of both sides are pretty damn low. Demon Hunter out of position. There's one big invul potion going for the Naga. Now what a damage! Holy cow! And it's GG for Shaddai.
Alright, Shaddai microing his heart out. But not enough. Not quite enough. Thomas G takes it, and yeah, kind of what we were expecting, that he's gonna be the big, not the big favorite. But if there was to be a favorite, then it should be him. And your Warcraft is totally spazzed and out. Second map, Shaddai, maybe he's gonna be able to come back, but it seemed like in that game, the timings totally didn't work out. He tried to go for some harassment with the DK to keep the Panda low. So he wanted to be aggressive. If you want to be that aggressive, why don't you go for the Naga? You know, he goes for the Lich, but the Naga is the way better pick there. And later on, he goes for the tier 3 timing, and he forgets about the destroyer timing, which is, of course, the destroyer upgrade is, of course, really bad. And when you go for that, you have to be scouting. When the Night Elf is creeping, you want to creep jack him. And he's, by the way, before found the sentry wards and sold them, which I always think is a terrible thing to do, like partial map hack to get rid of for 75 gold. I really don't understand it. Maybe he thought he was so scrapped for cash. But I don't think, you said Shaddai had a good performance against Hawk, maybe he overperformed. I agree, I think his play against Hawk was really good, but
what we just saw on map number one against Thomas G, that's not going to cut it at all.
No, never, ever. He really has to step up his game now. And Thomas G, maybe in the fights, it looked very bad for him against Warchief. But this game was kind of entirely different. I think the skill level matches now. And so it doesn't look like he's been toying around with, like it was in the Night of Mirror. He stands toe-to-toe with his opponent, and then experience counts, of course. And of course, it always feels like he has a game plan. He knows what to do, or what he wants to do. Of course, a Warchief interrupted that quite hard, but we saw how strong Warchief is against Hawk. So maybe Thomas G wasn't as weak as it seemed. And yeah, still good chances for him, though.
I think Thomas G also plays this matchup differently in one big aspect than that against Rich, and that is, here he is the reactive player, at least until tier 3. Once he reaches tier 3, he has Master Bears, he has 3-3 heroes, then maybe he goes for the offensive. And that is, honestly, the usual in this matchup. Nidalee gets the demon, he wants to stay back, he wants to creep, he wants to get level 3. And when he gets the second hero, usually that's the same. With a panda, at least, it's the same. When you get the Naga,
it's different.
It's different. Sure. You have the double slow, you have a really strong power spike once you get that right, as well as the Naga. But if you go for the panda, then you hang back, you want to try to be defensive, and it's up to the undead to harass and to hit the timings, or to power creep. That is the other option. But he did neither, really. He went for the Lich and went on the offensive.
Yeah.
And that is kind of like contradictory. So, as I said before, now for the third time, Shaddai's strategy, for me, doesn't really seem to be working out too well. And on Last Refuge, which is going to be our second map, maybe he's going to be going for the power creeping here, because there's a lot more creep camps here to take, and also very easy with destroyers. Lots of bloodlust casting, lots of inner fire casting. You get one destroyer, you can really run through the map. Maybe that's going to be a better map for him, because honestly, if it's similar to Amazonia, he's going to get wrecked again, because that game was not close at all.
Yeah, it's true. Last Refuge it is. And yeah, this is also an okay map for Worms, but you said Shaddai could transition into Worms. Do you have a feeling that he really wanted to do it? Because it was all so late. Like, the sacrificial pit was so late. I don't think he intended to go for the worms. Here, it might work out a little better.
Usually, in this matchup, the way it goes is you hit your tier 3 timing, and either you commit super hard to a lot of damage, or you want to look for some engagements on the map outside of the Night of Base and trade out your ghouls for his just barely 50 supply army. And when he has just barely his 50 supply army, it's not the perfect army. It's not like 3-4 dryads and the rest is bears. That's archers in there, which is of course not that great. Of course, ghouls in the late game aren't that great either. So usually when you go for that, you try to find engagements out on the map next to creep camps and stuff, and then behind that go for the worm transition. Or of course you don't go for the worm transition and try to hit a super hard time with more heal scrolls, with maybe more destroyers, maybe with earlier upkeep, you know. But it seemed like Shaddai really was indecisive. He didn't commit hard to either harassment or creeping. Early push. Like, there was something of everything. There was a sacrificial pit in there. There was no boneyard. There was an attempt at creepjacking, but there was no Naga. The ghouls were missing. The ghouls came late. The timing was hit, but then he delayed it for the merchant. Then he went for the quick frenzy, but there was no destroyer for him. You know, everything was kind of off sync.
Okay, we are ready. We're waiting for the Russian casters here to start it. Of course, our friend Heveline is doing that at twitch.tv/Heveline if you want to enjoy Russian casting from the studio in Kirov. So that should be cool as well. So just open up two streams, I think. That's the best solution here. I think everything has been said about Last Refuge, about this matchup, about these two players. Thomas G, by the way, a former practice partner of Grubby. Everyone is, of course, familiar with Grubby. Before some big tournament that Grubby won in the end, he was practicing with Sokol and Thomas G, and he wrote a blog thanking them for their practice and stuff. That was really rare, I think. Back then, nobody really revealed their practice partners. But we got that little info.
Out of those two, who do you think will have the better chance against Hawk, by the way? Because that is what it's about. Next round, we're going to be determining who is the second player to go into the playoffs. I mean, Hawk is the favorite, no question there. But who has the better chances?
Well, I think Shaddai did the best he could already in the best of three. And I don't think he can do this again. That would be huge. But
so you think Thomas G would be more likely to have a chance?
Yeah, I really do.
I think so too. I think in general he might be a little bit better of a player. I think it's unfair though for us to say that Shaddai is way better than way worse than Thomas G. I think it's coming down to the matchup again. Against Hawk, we saw some signs of really strong performance, but as we started the first map, we told you about the statistics, and statistics aren't always reliable, and you can't always draw conclusions from them, but I think here you can. I think it's really starting to show that this is Shaddai's worst matchup.
I hope at least for him that this is his worst matchup. But yeah, we're going to see about that. Will the Russian come back, or will we have Denmark versus Russia number two in Thomas G versus Shaddai? And the winner bracket semifinal looked like Danish Dynamite is not really explosive here today on this Thursday, but last game looked a lot better. We see the starting positions here on Last Refuge. Thomas G in the upper right with the Demon Hunter first, obviously going for a little creep spots here. And on the other side, Shaddai wearing the red trunks with the Death Knight first and the usual opening.
Yep, it's going to be the ghouls. Last game we saw a different approach from Shaddai, heading right over for some harassment. And on Amazonia, it is much easier for the Demon Hunter to get level 2 immediately, or almost immediately. On Amazonia, on Last Refuge, a lot harder to pull off. So maybe this aggression is going to be accompanied with a few more ghouls early on. Maybe Shaddai can use his micro, which isn't too bad at all, to be honest, to find maybe a few early surrounds here onto the Demon Hunter. Ideally, force a TP, force him to be way more careful. Or is he going to be playing it passively? That's the big question here for the early game.
I think on Amazonia, there's a good potential to be aggressive because the main bases are so close to each other, so the ghoul rush is a little faster and therefore more powerful. Last Refuge, you see the distance, it's quite far away, so it takes more time. And if he plays passive on Amazonia, I think we can conclude that he's going to stay passive on Last Refuge as well.
But I think the bigger deal is going to be the level 2 for the Demon Hunter. And as I said, on Amazonia, easier to get, much easier than on Last Refuge. He's trying to force the end snare here on the Archer, would most likely result in her death, but there's not going to be such a thing. Tier 2 for the Naive this time started very early on. Very confident on 3 Moonwells and only 2 Archers. And Shaddai is behind in that regard. He's going to be following suit in just a second here, though, I imagine. There we go.
Yeah, there's no graveyard just yet. But I don't think there's going to be Gargs or anything. There's always, of course, the possibility in this matchup to go for Gargs to play it a little more old school. But do you really want to play it old school versus a player who had the most successful time of his career in 2010 and 11? I don't think so. Death Knight, zero experience, but you were right. He pulls the cavalry. The ghoul gang is on the way.
Might be going for some creeping, though, now. Yeah, he's going for the High Priest, right? It's called High Priest. There we go. We'll hope for some sentry wards, and if he finds them, please don't sell them again, man. It's a good item, believe me. Gets a replenishment potion. Also nice, obviously, before statues. There is no reason for the undead race. Demon Hunter walking around the map, trying to find the undead.
Exactly.
And not doing anything so far.
This is really cool for Shaddai. Evasion creeping, as Grubby would say, but now he finds them, and so we'll get a lot of mana burns, I guess, but not level 2 here. Demon Hunter's also not level 2. Getting the boots, though. Archers close to his base. Not too much going on. Very passive first early game.
Yeah, this is a good trade, though, for Shaddai. I think he's going to get his level 2 right now. And Thomas G is too afraid to creep anything, but the Ancient of War has walked into position, but there's a skeleton here. Very nice scouting by Shaddai.
Yeah, this is really a little indicator of how good undead players are, the usage of the skeletons, across the entire game. Not only in the early game, a lot of players scout in the early game, but if you send out a lot of skeletons, you see this is the upper level of undead play most of the time. Of course, this is the rule of thumb here. And yeah, Demon Hunter getting level 2 here as well. Claws of Attack, he really likes those.
Very nice inventory. He was too scared to go for the Merc Camp creep as he saw that he was being scouted by a skeleton. And Shaddai trying to check if he's there, but he is not.
Thomas G is affected by the curse of the Night Elves. The Huntress Hall is too late.
But on the other only a few seconds. Okay. I think we can forgive him.
This is the graveyard is in time. Pen and Brewmaster once again.
Is it going to be the second hero? Oh, nice call. Yeah. Gets rid of the Wisp for no detonate, and there is the Naga. Now the slow has to come out, and this should be a surround onto the Panda. Yeah, this should definitely be easily accomplished, and there we go. Finally, the Naga first being picked off for the aggression to come. This is a good combination for the undead. Gets rid of the second hero easy, and now if he keeps his Naga alive, this is perfect. Maybe trying to go for a surround on the demon as well, because he is low. Can he block his Naga to safety to stay alive? I don't think so.
No, there was no intention of saving her, as it seemed. And no second surround of the Demon Hunter. Oh, maybe now. No, he sends the ghouls away. He can't really keep the surround close. Is there a coil? Nope, there's no mana, and Moon Juice is near. The Demon Hunter is safe. But, yeah, okay trade, because the Naga doesn't need to level, so he buys some time from the Panda.
I think that's a really good trade for Shaddai. First of all, Panda needs levels more, and second of all, his Naga got experience, the Panda didn't. He died first. Demon Hunter, though, now scarily close to level 3. And once he's there, the Naga of Shaddai has to be really careful. But tier 3 on its way. Slaughterhouse on its way. And once there's a statue, suddenly the Demon Hunter isn't that scary anymore. You get a lot of healing out of those Oblivion statues. And the DK would love to keep down the creeping for the Night Elf even further.
It's hard without a coil, and with the Engine of War here, and the Panda, of course, can block a lot of damage as well. Who is back to the battlefield? Four archers still on the fray. Death Knight, 2.5. Naga is back as well.
Oh, the Demon Hunter might walk into a surround here. Is he gonna get it? I think so. He got it.
Wow. Really good, man. You suggested it to be a little more aggressive, to go for the surrounds, because Shaddai really knows how to move his army, and he listened, and two good surrounds.
And here comes the next creep jack. If the Panda gets found here again and is surrounded again, that might just be a huge catastrophe for him. One coil coming in, he's going for the archers though. Only one of these creeps from the camp has been taken. Panda not yet level 2, this is a way better early game. Dryads should be coming soon though, then this might be turning around. If he gets the Demon Hunter here, he has no more TP. This would be a massive pickoff. Here come the Wisps for Detonate though. He sees the Dryads. This might be the sign to retreat now for Shaddai, as the slow will be hitting the first few ghouls. He would ideally like to get the Fiend here. The Demon Hunter though, he's not invulnerable. He is on 270 HP, may have to be careful. Where are the statues? They should be inbound fairly soon. The ghouls starting to drop low though, and I think finally, Thomas G should be stabilizing here.
I agree. With the Dryads comes the power of the Night Elf, but the Demon Hunter once again level 3. He blocks his way through. There is no coil, and there is no Fork Lightning, and there is no Lich. So Demon Hunter gets away for the second time, or the third time actually, if you include the surround. So yeah, Panda will get his level 2. Finally, Demon Hunter has his level 3 here. So the Danish player is coming back into this game. Statues are here, as you mentioned, the Lich is on the way, and then he has really the big power spike with Frenzy, with the Orb. Destroyer upgrade will be a little late.
But I forgot about it again.
There it is.
There's no reason to get it that late, honestly. He had the resources. The Demon Hunter, man, this is really dangerous. He has no more TP. Ballsy. We can give him that much.
Tier 3 for the Night Elf is about to be finished as well, and once again the Destroyer upgrade will line up with the Master upgrade of the Bears. I think the Master upgrade will be a little faster even. So we have Mana Stealing, which is not too great. Chance for a ton of experience though on the Trappers.
Oh, it's going for the Heal Scroll. This might be a big dedicated push. Is the Panda going to be able to hit level 3 before? I don't think so. It's very close though, Tome of Experience.
No, that would have been level 3 for him. Demon Hunter is going for the Invo Potion and big healing, which is of course nice. Thomas G is really not unlucky with his drops.
What did he get? Ah, they were with Major at the Merc Camp. Is it gonna be another heal scroll?
I think so. There's two available.
Oh, this looks like a big commitment. There's no transition at all. No sacrificial pit, no boneyard, no upgrades on the fiends or anything. Koinova, Dimahar, you need to take a lot of damage, but he will be able to back up to the Riju, or will he? No! Has to use the greater healing already. That was a big mistake. Honestly, where was the Riju, man? Now it comes onto the bear. No, actually, it was onto the Demon Hunter, but the big healing is gone. The level 3 demon, the king on the battlefield, but the ghoul still okay in shape. Where's the heal scroll? The first one to be coming out. He's going for the surround. No, actually, going for the back line for the Dryads. They're being microed back, though. More and more mana burns coming in. The panda in trouble. There's no stab. There is, actually. Didn't see it. The panda gets saved. The Demon Hunter still standing strong in the front lines. Has the invulnerability as well, but now the Dryad is starting to fall one after the other, and only one bear on the battlefield.
Yeah, the Destroyer has to be microed away though. Oh, but nice little micro by Shaddai. Nah, in the end, the Dryad gets him, but dies. So the bear will die in a second as well. The panda needs to use a potion. The lich is kind of surrounded by the demon hunter and the bear, but will get out. The panda uses the potion. Lich in trouble. There's no more coil. Can he staff him? The demon hunter is not staffing his ally out. There was an invul potion and a step. Can the lich escape with the Zeppelin? This was just brilliant. Warcraft, I should die. The demon hunter is almost blocked here. Tries to block again and again. 100 HP. Ah, oh, but there's rejuvenation now. But amazing fight by Shaddai.
And now does he keep on going? He has no mana and the lich is basically dead. Loads him into the Zeppelin, keeps him alive. There's no destroyers against rejuvenation at the moment. The shop, though, so exposed, could be easily killed. And he will do so right now. The lich, the mana burn would kill him, actually. But the mana burn goes on towards the DK. This statue now being absolutely necessary to sustain this push. And if he doesn't kill the base, or too many more buildings, at least he should be able to take out the Ogre, and that is in and of itself a big pick. Panda, as we can see right there in the production, is gonna take quite a bit longer behind this, but doesn't look like we have a late game Boneyard transition. Still more and more statues coming in.
Lich is level 2, Naga level 2, Lich, the Death Knight level 3. On the other side, the Demon Hunter has to carry hard for the Night Elf player. He's buying some time here, getting more bears out, but he's down to 35 food. This is not much. 45 for the undead.
Does he have any ghouls here?
Yeah, he's in the main, you mean?
At home, only two.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's okay. But there's still two ghouls remaining here in the army. This is quite rare after the first fight. Usually you lose them all.
Yeah, they're not too strong anymore. Decent damage. All right, Panda is back. Three bears. He does not have enough in the air. Not enough burst to get rid of these bears. I don't think so, at least. First ride, bear will be... Phoenix will be falling. Level 3 for the Panda. Where's the breath? Nowhere. Invul has to be used fairly quickly. Panda again in trouble. There is the staff, however, available. We have to remember level 4 now for the demon. Retreating backward. He needs to use the staff sooner rather than later and does do so.
How is the situation at the moon? Well, tier 72. It's not too much left anymore. It's nighttime, though. The Zeppelin gets attacked by the demon hunter. At least he can attack something. Additional experience for the undead. And finally, he gets a mana stone! This is an absolute amazing item. Like a combination of a Sobby mask, a weaker Sobby mask, and a heal and a mana potion, the big one.
We have the Boneyard, by the way, coming now. So he is gonna be opting for the late game. Shaddai is.
Get items? Yeah, heal scroll and invul potion again. He's scouting for an expansion. He's so scared of a plan B of Thomas G.
I really like the Zeppelin, man. Saved his lich, distracted the army so he can get the Ogre. Now it's scouting. Doesn't cost supply, by the way, guys. Not everyone knows this. The Zeppelin, the only unit in the game that doesn't cost supply.
Do shades cost supply?
Yes, one supply. It's an acolyte, bro. Right, taking out the Ogre, Khadgar's Pipe of Insight, the dream for him.
Warsong Battle Drums, also amazing. Immediate town portal out because the Night Elf is approaching here. He doesn't kill anything though.
He actually rebought the TP. I really like that move. Once you get the red spot, and in case there is a an attack coming, a backstab, a creep jack, he gets the TP because he doesn't really want to fight right now. He doesn't have the perfect army. It's only like one destroyer and I think two fiends, maybe three. When he has the Frostworm, yeah, Then he will like to fight, but he wants some mana, you know, he wants some time, he would like to creep some. He wants to get the next red camp, and there's another TP. Is he gonna be able to get the big one before the army is fully here? I think so. Bears are pretty slow, and he gets the Ogre Lord, giving him...
Awesome battle drums again.
They don't stack, though.
No, unfortunately for Shaddai, they don't, but it's level 4 for him. He doesn't even have to use the town portal at the moment, gets a lot of experience here. Naga's level 3, Lich is about to be level 3. Here comes the Jag, town portal's out. All right.
Doesn't lose anything again, though. That's good. Basically, the money for the TP is almost received again by selling the Warsong Battle Drums, and he got some experience on top of things. And
of course, you could argue now that, okay, this move wasn't too good because he did get the same item and it doesn't stack, so he has to sell them and he loses money because the town portal is more, more expensive than the item if you sell it. But this means that Thomas G won't get the Warsong Battle Drums, and Battle Drums work incredible on Bears and Dryads, so stealing this is definitely worth it.
Yeah. I think also that was a very good move, and now that he TPs home, Panda of Energy, very nice, so much mana on the Panda. He gets more creep more on his side of the map, you know, he gets to go home very fast. Of course, Rune Bracer is very bad, will be sold. But yeah, he gets to creep the bottom side of the map now. Does he have another TP to get out another time if he's being creep checked?
Yep.
He does.
That's
so
1,000 gold in town portals.
Yeah, but he's going to get a lot of that back from the items that he sells and also the creeps just that he kills. And it's experience. Experience. And once you get like 4 heroes, that is so strong for you. The Demon Hunter can't burn everything anymore. And of course, the nuke will be incredible.
57 food for Shaddai. Thomas G is finding him again, but once again it is a little too late. Demon Hunter is getting close to level 5, though first mana, but Coil Nova comes immediately after. There's an Invo Potion, he has to use it, and Rejuvenation. Is there a Dispel from the Destroyer? Yes, he gets it.
Doesn't chase after it, why not? The Demon Hunter is so low, now he has some time for another Reju. Little bit slow there. Shade, by the way, finding the expansion up here, but the fight might still be happening. Only 5 bears, that's not too many. Where's the first destroyer? I imagine it must be in production.
First worm, you mean? Almost finished. On the other side, we have an engine of wind coming to fight this. He gets the Ogre Magi, Circle of Nobility, and once again, not losing. Oh, this time it loses the Fiend, but it's still very, very okay. The Panda will find level 4, though. This is all the time that he needed for the worm transition, which takes a lot of time.
And now he gets the Ogre as well. So many creeps for Shaddai. I would really like to see him keep his TP away. Well, then again, level 3 core is pretty damn good.
Yeah, level 4 doesn't do too much for those heroes.
No, I don't know. Dark Ritual, lots of mana. Level 2, either Cold Arrow or Fog Lightning. I think they all have their value. Finding also here the healing wards can be very good, but then again might just be dispelled immediately by Dryads.
4-4-3 heroes for the undead, 4-4 for the Night Elf. It shows you how much more of this map Shaddai got. 4 bears, 5 bears, 3 Dryads. Is this too few Dryads?
Yeah, it's not many at all, right? Like, how is he gonna kill one worm and 2 destroyers with this?
The Demon Hunter has to carry hop, but it's only plus 11. And he goes hippos.
Is there web?
Is there web? That's a good question I cannot answer right now.
Because if he doesn't have him, might be getting caught out unawares. Now there's only one hippo, but there will be more very soon. I think he saw it though.
3 destroyers with mana. This is so much damage. Area of effect as well. He has web. And this looks like the perfect situation for the undead. 68 versus 62, getting rid of the Hippogriff immediately. The meat shield is going down and down, but it's only ghouls. It's definitely okay to lose them. The heavy air is still almost untouched, and he's kiting well, getting rid of all the Hippogriffs.
I think this is way too many bears, honestly. Now the hippos are down, only 3 Dryads on the battlegrounds. The Panda in focus, no invul on him, by the way. The focus is coming in, taking lots of damage. There is the staff. Of course, he doesn't use it! Are you kidding me? He uses it too late on a bear that was actually full HP. Oh my god, what a mistake. Panda out of the fight. There's no splash damage now really coming out, and the bears melting to the magic damage. He might be getting rid of the Frostworm. Actually, there's another coil. But look at the damage onto the bears. It was 6 just a second ago. Now it's only 2 left, and make that actually 1. Level 5 for the DK as well. Healing wards in the back. Very nice. Now the Demon Hunter in focus. The Frostworm very well microed here above the trees. And this is, I think, too much Invul coming out. But how can he win this fight?
I have no idea, man. The Demon Hunter, once the Invul potion is over, will be falling, I guess. The shots coming in. Town portals out. He wants to keep a little chance of this alive, but I have no idea how this should be working. Amazing fight by Shedai. Of course, Thomas G has this expansion working, but it's only 3 wisps inside. Now he moves the fourth one in, but still, he has only 41 food. It's 760 gold remaining. Okay, maybe this is the usual... Oh, nice. The usual Night Elf late game where he will go for the expansion here at the red spot, but I'm not too sure. Yeah, this is so much damage. He won't keep the Tree of Life alive. It's a level 5 DK, and those heroes are not far away from level 5 as well.
And not just the spells, also the right clicks at this point are so significant from the Naga and the Lich. They may not have the greatest items, but they get extra damage every level. And the tree falls. And now the undead army is being joined by quite a few new forces. Actually, he misrallied and left a lot of units at home when he produced during the fight.
2 A-bombs will be amazing versus all the Dryads. He's still trying to go for Hippos, but if you encounter 3 fiends and you don't really know 4 fiends and you don't really know how to crack them before, this won't work.
That's exactly what we saw from WFZ versus Foggy in the GCS qualifier. With Hippos, you go big or you go home. Either you mass produce them or you don't. If you only have 2 or 3 at a time and there's enough fiends, they just got webbed and they're useless, they're dead weight on the ground. And this, I think the big mistake here was obviously no Invul on the Panda and way too many bears. Might be coming the finishing
point. Yeah, look at the inventory. 2 heal scrolls, 1 protection scroll even. We rarely see that on undead heroes. And 2 Invul potions as well. There's the staff, so that means there's no staff for the Panda if he gets focused for 30 seconds. Position is okay though, he can hide behind his trees.
But it's also going to be very hard to come in here though. To approach the undead army. Oh, the Demon Hunter taking so much damage and there's no stab for him! Fork Lightning will be his demise. And that is it.
GG and Shedai showing a completely different game than on map number 1. This was like someone else was playing for
this
him
was
actually.
Night and day. Absolutely. Absolutely a different player it seemed. And this time it worked out. He wanted to go for some aggression, and he had the right tools. He had the early Naga, he got the fast pickoff on the Panda. He pressures more, he delays him more, and then he says, all right, riots are coming out, I need to retreat now, I need to fall back. He gives him like 30 more seconds, but then the next timing hits. He has the Lich, he has the Orb. And then he goes for the double heal source. There I was thinking, oh man, you're committing hard right now, there's no backup, no... You know, damage upgrades for the fiends, there's no Frostworm, but he gets a lot of damage done. So this really pays off, and he falls back a little bit again, he goes for the Boneyard. So this time I really liked his play. It all fitted together well, was really cool. Well done. I'm surprised. I thought this may just be a clean 2-0 sweep.
The next map we're gonna see is Echo Isles. What do you think about that?
Pretty similar to Last Refuge in many regards. Usually not that easy of a level 2 for the Night Elf, unless he goes for the Merc Camp, but that can be heavily punished. That can be heavily, heavily punished. Also, the Panda won't be able to find level 3 too easily here if the Undead prioritizes pressuring. So I think a fast tech with a Naga, possibly again for early pressure, could be a good option for Shedai. Unless, of course, the Demon Hunter finds level 3 miraculously. But then again, if you don't go for the Merc Camp, usually not too easily achieved.
Yeah. I'm not too sure. I think it's okay. There's also potential for a Ghoul Rush, but I don't think we're going to see this from Shedai. He played very, very standard. One time good, one time bad standard. So, yeah, it's going to be the question. Which Shedai are we going to see?
Maybe he was felt a little bit of nervousness again going into this best of 3. He played against Hawk
Actually, his performance got worse against Hawk. First game very good, and he got worse and worse as it went on through the series. Now it seems to be the other way around. Maybe he was a little bit nervous heading into the second best of three here against Thomas G. Maybe he's getting used to the flow right now again, and he's feeling more comfortable. It was definitely, as I said before, night and day between game number one and game number two. And now it's all down to our next map, to Echo Isles, who goes up against Hawk. And of course, then it's going to be the real big challenge, to be honest.
What a cool group this is, man. It's the third series that goes into the third map. We had Shaddai versus Hawk, then we had Hawk versus Warchief, and now Shaddai versus Thomas G, also a three mapper. And of course, that's what we want to see. Intense series, close series. So one map to determine who's going to drop out and who's going to advance to the loser bracket final and the last spot into the playoffs versus Hawk.
And we said before, most likely Thomas G has the better chances, seen as how Hawk does not like the matchup against Night Elves. But, Shaddai also showed that he can do it, if he has a good game, though. I think that's what it takes. I think if it's even footing, Hawk will most likely take it. If he has a good start, if he can get rolling, though, maybe he's going to be able to. Well, this group, though, you say it's a cool group. It's going the distance in many cases in this series. But all in all, no upsets. It is
that's
the
right.
way we expected.
Well, we had the very first game was an upset that,
yeah,
that Shaddai...
But a map being taken.
Yeah, okay, that's true. But I think it was very hard for the underdogs here to achieve something very surprising.
I mean, apart from that one big victory for Yaws at the WCA last year, these are the two most decorated European players that we have here in this tournament.
Well, Foggy, of course.
Yeah, but I mean, when we look back and we have Hawk at WEC back then,
that is true.
And Rich at the WCA qualifier
yeah,
and stuff,
that's right.
Might be a step above Foggy.
Yeah.
I think, though, Foggy, actually looking forward a little bit towards the coming days, if he manages to get a grip on himself, if he doesn't become nervous again, I think he's actually the strongest player here in this group.
I agree.
He dropped out against WFZ in the GCS qualifier number one, but I think that was kind of his own undoing. He had really good games, looked really strong, but then he forgot about moon wells and stuff, got supply stacks.
Yeah,
stuck,
really,
silly,
really stupid,
silly little moves.
Stupid mistakes or easy mistakes to do. He's really stepping up his game, Foggy. I remember last year when we were talking about him, we were so impressed by his creative strategies, and we were talking about how this could be the next big guy, and some people say, oh, Foggy, all he can is doing his strategies, like, there's no...
Yeah, his good cheesy stuff.
Exactly, there's no good mechanics behind that, there's no good micro behind that, there's no good decision-making behind that. But that totally changed, and that was not a misjudgment by these people who said it, but it is the development of Foggy throughout a year.
Exactly.
We all said, okay, his dream of WCA was crushed twice now because he failed to qualify 2014, then 2015 he failed to qualify. And we thought, okay, is this the end for Foggy here? Will he quit maybe? But no, he came from this two defeats even stronger, practiced even more, got a coach to help him, went to China to play GCS, plays a lot of NetEase, wins iFang Cups in China here and there. So this is definitely the player to look out for.
Yeah, and I really like seeing this when people put in the work, put in the effort, the hours, you know, the workhorses. They have this dream, they have this drive in them to achieve this goal, and then they work for it and they get there. And I think that's so cool to see. Foggy's one of those players. He may not necessarily be the most talented man you've ever seen on this earth, but he puts on the hours and he gets it done. And as he said himself at GCS in Shanghai, 30 catgas a day and anyone can do it. And that's the little man's dream, man. You put in the effort and you can get where you want to get.
To that. The game is about to start, though, here. We take one more look into this bracket, which is not updated, so maybe we don't. Well, I can update this real quick. Because for people who tuned in late, I will show you what happened today before we jump in into the last map of Shaddai versus Thomas G. Right.
I believe they're asking you if you're ready.
Yes. Okay. Here we go. Brackets. This is what we saw today. Losers semifinal. Shaddai versus Thomas G. It is 1-1. The loser will drop out. The winner will continue into the lower bracket final versus Hawk. And Remo, we are jumping in to Echo Owls.
All right, which Shaddai we're gonna see? It certainly looked like two completely different performances, maybe like two completely different players. Shaddai, map number one, maybe he was nervous, I don't know. Nothing was working, honestly. Map number two, he had a certain strategy in mind, he had certain goals to achieve that game, and he accomplished most of them and was able to take an impressive victory. Now, Echo Isles, what's it gonna be? It's not gonna be a greedy creep camp here from the Night Elf player. He's not gonna try to rush to level two and fear being punished for it. He's gonna go the standard route. This means the Demon Hunter is gonna have a fairly difficult time getting to level two. Is Shaddai gonna try to abuse this with some pressure? On Last Refuge, he kind of faked the pressure and then transitioned into creeping so that he was able to get level two before his opponent. And maybe that's gonna be done this time again by him. We're gonna see.
Alright, this is, of course, the Death Knight first. His opponent is no Warden. People like Sonic sometimes play the Warden against Undead. But no, Thomas G sticking to his gun, sticking to his Demon Hunter. And yeah, this is definitely a better position, I feel, because you're way more safe. You don't have to walk back the entire thing when there's a Ghoul Rush coming. What should I... With the Ghoul Scout, we're gonna see what he wants to do here.
The most important thing is it gathers information, sees, all right, you're not going for the Greedy Merc Camp. Oftentimes when Undead see the Greedy Merc Camp, they immediately pull two new ghouls from the main and walk them over as well. And then there's three ghouls harassing you while you're creeping the Merc Camp. You have to repair, you have to use the Lightning Shield, you're slowed, you're purged, everything's a disaster. And you can lose the game right there. But no, standard play. And the Demon Hunter finding the first Ring of Protection. Unfortunate for him, of course.
Yeah, Lady Luck was good to him in the past few games, so starting off with Ring of Protection is fairly deserved, I think. Death Knight is immediately running over, setting the town portal for Dust and Rod of Necromancy. And yeah, more ghouls are coming. Is this the standard amount of ghouls?
Yeah, it's the usual one. Usually on its take on 22 or 24 supply. I think he does it on 24 slightly later. But it is standard. This time, though, we have Thomas G going for more archers. On Last Refuge, he teched with only two. Wants to be a little bit safer here. Of course, the distance is way shorter. Everything is being saved the way it's supposed to be. Archer survives, Wisp survives. And where's the tech? Should we be? He's going to 26 supply for teching.
I mentioned this looked weird to me.
It's a little later than normal. But he has the resources now. And there we go.
Okay, there we go. Five ghouls are coming over. And, well, one moon is already gone from the moon juice. And yeah, there's not too much in there. But the Demon Hunter, not level two. He didn't have the time to creep this one entirely. And. Shaddai fairly aggressive here. Looks like this recipe is working better for him. He forgets about the ghoul gang, though. At least a bit.
It's a lot of ghouls, by the way. There's seven ghouls. It's a lot of commitment. He's reproducing some at home as well, but with seven ghouls being on the offensive, and one might be falling here. Yep. A few archer shots finish the job. Maybe wants to go for the moonlight, but it's being repaired. Could possibly surround the demon, but he has immolation.
Interesting. This is a nice little defense. Does he feel forced, or was it his plan all along? We're gonna see about that. This is, of course, not the perfect position for the ghouls to run in there, but the archers can't really hide anymore. Level 2 thanks to the detonate. But there's so much mana gone, so if he focuses the Demon Hunter once his mana is gone, he needs so much moon juice. I don't think if that's the perfect solution for Thomas G here.
I wonder what the kill score is. This must be like the second archer against the second ghoul, so evenly trading across the board. But also the Wisp have to come in for detonate, as it seems. That's also going to be hurtful towards the tech later on. And the Frostmourne Hunters, of course, as we know, we're gonna be able to find one more archer, and the Moonwells are dry, and as you said, the Demon Hunter low on mana, healing him back up again is gonna be hard, but I think the main damage here has been done. Only two ghouls will be remaining as he finds another one here. I think this aggression will be coming to an end.
Yeah.
But lots of archers have been killed.
I have to correct myself. This was the best solution for Thomas G. There's no damage anymore to be done by Shaddai. All his ghouls are dead. No level 2 for the Death Knight. Level 2.5 for the Demon Hunter. He killed quite a lot. But the presence of Shaddai in this main base once again delayed the Hunter's Hall. And this time, we don't have to argue that this is really late.
And he also reproduced so many archers. We saw the experience there on the DK 170. Remember, no creeps being taken. So that is a lot of archers and wisps. And also wisps were detonated. They gave no experience, so he lost even more. So Thomas G definitely taking a lot of damage here. And on level 3, he's going to get mana burn level 2, so there's no evasion. The immolation isn't going to be good going towards the mid and late game, and he's going for the Naga again.
Yeah, Shaddai knows about this. Four ghouls coming in, but this is a very risky creep spot now. Level 3, big mana potion, but what's it worth?
He steals it!
Yeah, he steals it close to level 2, but can he get the damage out there? Slow from the Naga. Can he get this round? Nice block from the goat! This should be the end. No, the town portal, but Moon Juice. Not too much available.
Can he heal up again? Is he gonna be full? Not really.
Not really, man. This
we have
is
a
dangerous.
Little bit of day and moon, nighttime, moon time, lol, remaining. But then it's gonna be day for a long time. And rejuvenation is so far away. I love this Naga pick to follow up the aggression. He is really, really putting on the stepping on the pedal this game.
Two Ancients of Lores are coming up. This one in a dangerous position, man. Okay, the Ancient of Lores, big buddy. Standing there to protect him a bit. Shaddai with the Slaughterhouse tier 3 on the way as well, but here he comes. Panda?
Wow.
This late?
I guess he thinks he has level 3 Demon Hunter right now, but that's not the end all be all, man. He's strong, yeah, but he needs healing, and Moonwells are not going to be giving it. And with Shaddai being in the main base, he should have seen, oh, you got barely any moon juice, man. I should be able to keep up the pressure, but of course, the Breath of Fire now is going to be great against all the ghouls. Going for the Naga. Usually a good idea, but you need the boots for that, and he had no time at all yet to get the boots.
That's true, he can't go down to the 6 o'clock position. Demon Hunter is catching more and more hits here. But yeah, Shaddai is playing this so much better than the first map.
Yeah, definitely, man. He really hit his stride here in this series. I like to see that, otherwise it would have been a very one-sided game. Only 5 ghouls remaining now, though. That means even if he goes for Frenzy, it's not going to be the most deadly. He's not going to have so many ghouls to walk out with. The Naga in trouble. Mana burn gets a really low. No more mana for Cold Arrow.
Nice mana burn on the Demon Hunt, on the Death Knight as well, so no coil available. Could have prevented that by just throwing the coil onto the demon, forcing him to heal up even more. And yeah, look at this, man. All dry. But the Giants are coming, speaking of dry. but he cancelled the one lore, and this is fairly late to rebuild it. So his Dryad production and Bear production, obviously.
And also his tier 3, man. It's so late. All of the killed Wisps and the Archers that had to be reproduced, they're really starting to show in his economy and in his tech, as it's now so late.
Shaddai is already finished with this tech. He has the first Fiend. Only waiting for his Lich to start things. And there we go. Frenzy, Lich, and then this push will be so deadly.
He doesn't even go for bears. Look at this. He gets more Dryads. There's no healing.
Riju would be really cool. Riju would really be beneficial.
He's a little bit of moon juice left, but not much at all.
This is nothing.
About 200 mana. A little bit more than 200 mana, but that ain't so good. Here comes Destroyer form. We have Frenzy in just a second. Is he gonna get impatient? Does he want to hit before the Lich, before the orb? I would have liked to see the DK going south and maybe dissuade Night Elf from creeping. Oh, could this be a surround? There's no boots on the demon! If he gets the surround and the kill, but the Fiend is blocking the Naga and the demon gets away.
Mistake here, the Panda's creeping up with once again a ring of protection. Okay, here we go. Normal damage working good against buildings, so what can he accomplish? Destroyer upgrade is almost finished, and this time he is way faster than the Bear Master upgrade. He gets the Adept now and the first Bear now, but yeah, everything is super duper late. There's no shop, there's no staff, there's no Riju, there is nothing basically except four Dryads. The Lich is coming with the Orb.
I don't even know if the Bears have Adept.
It's in the works.
No, it was abolish magic. We're gonna see when the first one hits the battlefield here. It's gonna be coming from the back. So it is a pretty big army for the Night Elf, but it's not so good, man. It's just Dryads and Archers. And here is the Lich with the Orb. What was that? Breath of Fire. With the Orb of Venom. But it is Adept. He does have Adept. Finally, he has Riju. But the next mover will be falling. Here comes the Nova going on towards the Archers first. And the Dryads will be next in line. The one destroyer up in the air trying to get rid of the rejuvenation, but actually it's running on the demon. He is healed up again, eating the first bit of damage, and the heal potion has to be used soon if he doesn't want to die. There we go, going towards the Moombas, healing up a bit more. Now the panda in trouble as well, but the ghouls, nice roll of healing, healing them back up again. And the panda retreats to the safety of the Moonwells as well, but the bear might be the next in line. Actually doesn't focus him, the destroyer
demon
has to
be- hunter dies! Oh my god, the Lich is doing this, and GG by Thomas G. And as, well, we didn't expect after game one, Shaddai was taking this, breaking the curse of his horrible statistics versus Night Elf. This is, I cannot believe the difference between map 1 and 2 and 3.
You just have, you know, you have off games every now and then. It happens.
Yeah, that was like, off all cliffs in the world.
It was pretty bad.
But yeah, we get a rematch, man. Shaddai versus Hawk will be our loser bracket final. One of those two players will meet with Warchief in the truck into the playoffs.
Ah, okay.
He will meet Yoss, Foggy, Cash, or Sheik from Group D.
Yep, so we have our last series of today determined who is going to join Warchief in the playoffs. Hawk or Shaddai? Again, we have to say Hawk is the big favorite, but we saw this game as our first game of the day, right?
Yeah.
That's the first one. It's going to be a rematch, and Shaddai showed he can take a map
exactly.
of Hawk, and it was very close, man. He almost got the 2-0, then he kind of fell apart,
yeah.
But it was so close, man. So if he's there mentally, if he doesn't herpy-derp like game number one against Thomas G, then he may just have a good chance.
Speaking of Thomas G, I want to point out that it is so cool to see the old school players come back, mixing in with the young bloods of the scene, and still, this is some very cool flavor that they add, and many tried it, like Effect, SoCool, DeLorean. We have seen a lot of old pro players coming back and try their luck. Thomas G was one of the most successful of these attempts, and it was pretty damn cool to see him back, especially in the Open Qualifier, where he created this cool upset against Chechi, where he beat Imperius, which was, for me at least, not to be expected. And yeah, so too bad that he ended up fourth, but this was a cool flavor to this tournament to see the Danish player back.
And yeah, nothing much to add to that. Hopefully he's going to stay with the scene a little bit, maybe though he is going to be making his exit, I don't know. You know what, I'm going to ask him if he wants to go for an interview.
Okay.
Maybe he feels in the mood, possibly not though, right after losing.
Yeah,
players like to stay to themselves. I'm going to ask him. We're going to be heading into a break here, guys. There's going to be videoing going on, obviously. And then there is the last series of today coming up shortly. So you guys stay tuned and we'll be back in a little while.
True that. Gotta this one here.
If you just tuned in a few minutes ago or something. If you haven't heard yet, there's lots of Warcraft, man, coming up these next couple of days. We have 4 days of group stages. Today is the first day, then there's 1 day break, and there's 3 days of playoffs coming right after to determine which two of the Europeans will be joining the international roster of Warcraft 3 players in Yinchuan, China later this year for the WCA main event for a hell of a lot of cash. I think the prize pool in total is more than 100,000. Is that confirmed? I don't know. Anyways, it's a lot of money and it's a lot of prestige as well. And as a little extra here, as a little extra special thing, we have at Back to Warcraft for this stay in Hamburg for this stream of the WCA EU qualifier. Last year in Yinchuan, I hunted down lots of the pro players and got their signatures for you guys. And finally, I waited for a good opportunity, and now this cast here is the right one. There is Moon on here, there's Sky on here, there's Lawliet, there's Yoss, there's HLA, there's Hawk, and many others. And you guys can win this. We're going to be raffling it out on Wednesday at some time. That's one day before our casting ends. And yeah, if you want to have a t-shirt signed by Moon and a lot of other great Warcraft players, tune in on Wednesday as well when we're going to be raffling that out. I think we're ready for the break now.
Yes, we are.
All right, so get something to drink, guys. Last series coming up soon.